a little more time before church to spend with everybody, but again, it just kind of didn't work out that way. But the Lord knows. It won't be just me going. You all go with me. You pray, your prayers, your financing, the people who are taking care of the church while we're gone. It's all a team effort. I'm just going to be there, the one doing it, but we need your prayers. Without the Lord blessing, we will not be able to do anything that matters, but with God, we can change a nation. And so let's make sure we're praying for the power of the Holy Spirit and safety and everything else. I think God would bless it. And we've done everything that we can do. Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 1. It says, "Wherefore, seeing we are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him that endured such contradictions of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. Ye have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin." I want to talk about just run with patience. Run with patience. Let's pray. Father, there's so many things in this passage that you worded so carefully that are so amazing and so powerful and so rich. And teach the whole picture, the big picture of running the Christian life. And what I think that many people don't run. Many people don't run with patience. Many people don't continue to keep their eyes focused. Many don't strive. And Lord, we want to run our race well. And we want to finish strong whenever you come back or we pass away. Either way, Lord, you want to be running the race strong, sprinting across in the finish line, because whenever we see you, that's the finish line. And I pray that we would be ready for that. I pray you give me wisdom and power as I preach. Lord, we need you. And tonight I pray to speak to each one of us. Thank you for the word and what it gives us tonight and this amazing passage here in Hebrews. We pray that you'd use it in our hearts and minds in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, we are surrounded by, we're in a stadium. I mean, it says you're surrounded by a great cloud of witnesses, verse 1. Seeing we're compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses. Compass means surround with such a great a cloud of witnesses. Let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does easily beset us. A lot of things there, but first of all, you're surrounded. You're in a stadium, okay, and there are a cloud of witnesses, okay? It's the context, of course. Remember, there's no chapter divisions when they wrote the Bible. It's Hebrews 11, and it tells us about who these people are. But you're surrounded, and you're compassed about, but they're called witnesses. They are watching. I don't know exactly if they have the ability that God has to see everything. They're in heaven. They're in glorified body. They're in glorified spirits and souls, and they may be watching all of us at the same time. We don't know. The Bible doesn't say. Some may be choosing to watch us, but the believers who have gone before us are watching us, and you're surrounded by them. And it's called a cloud of witnesses. And there's a reason for that, but you're actually in a stadium, and you're never not being watched. That's right. I mean, the old that thing that works on earth, but it doesn't work in heaven, okay? God's watching, the cloud of witnesses is watching, And, you know, just think, sometime when you're complaining because you have a bad day or traffic's bad or something, and Job's watching you, you know, and saying, you think you're having a bad day. But you're surrounded by that cloud of witnesses. And it says, because of that, you need to run your race right. And that should be a motivation for you, that you are being watched, and it's a part of the deal. Look, and it just kind of talks about them. If we give ourselves context in chapter 11, and he's already talked about, you know, Noah, Moses and Isaac and Noah and all these guys, and he's gone through Joseph and all of them and their faith, the hall of faith of Hebrews 11. But he goes, let me just kind of read you how he closes the chapter here a little bit, and then that's why he goes into chapter 12, verse 1. "And what more shall I say? For the time would fail me to tell of Gideon and of Barak and of Samson and of Jephthah and of David also and of Samuel and of the prophets. And then it just kind of talked about how they conquered, how they did great things through faith, because it's all through faith. Who through faith subdued kingdoms. Certainly Daniel did that. Wrought righteousness, obtained promises, stopped the mouth of lions, quenched the violence of fire, escaped the edge of the sword. And it just kind of goes on. Out of weakness were made strong, waxed valiant in fight, turned to flight the armies of the aliens. And women also, they did great things in faith. And they had children. They saw their children come to life again, and they died. They had deliverance. But then they also suffered the persecution, and that's also faith, the faith to follow God when it costs that price to do that. And verse 36, and others had trial of cruel mockings and scourgings, yea, moreover, bonds and imprisonments. They were stoned. They were sawn asunder. They were tempted. They were slain with a sword and vanquished. And they wandered about in sheepskins and goatskins, and being destitute, afflicted, and tormented, of whom the world is not worthy. And so you just look at all these people, what they've been through for faith. And just listening to it, we can't tell you about all of them, but they did it by faith. They changed the world. They handled everything. They saw resurrections. They saw all these things. But then really important things, verse 39 and 40, a real key going into chapter 12. And these all, having obtained a good report through faith, receive not the promise. They didn't get it all finished. They didn't see Jesus come and all those things. God, having provided some better thing for us, that they, without us, should not be made perfect. Whoa. A lot of people missed that verse there. They're not complete without us. This is the handing of the baton. And until Jesus comes, we're still continuing. And we're continuing it. They started.
That's right.
And so they are watching us finish their race. We're continuing that race. Wherefore, because of this, seeing where it comes about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Lots of things there. First of all, a couple things that Christianity of the world today would do well to do. He says, look, you're running the race, and you got to lay some things aside. Now, it lists a couple things. It says, of course, lay aside the sin, which does so easily beset us. But that's not all it says lay aside. It says lay aside weights.
That's right.
Some things are things, look, I could run a race and not break any rules, but I'm wearing, 4-pound combat boots or a 60-pound backpack. And I'm not going to do well in the race. I mean, I'm going to struggle, not because I did something wrong, but because I'm weighed down. And there's things in your life that are weights. There's friends that are weights. They keep you from serving God. There's hobbies. There's habits where we couldn't show a single Bible verse. It says the weights and the sin.
Right.
We couldn't show a single Bible verse that says thou shall not about something that's a weight to you. But when you're trying to live for God and when you're looking at eternity and you're trying to serve God and really, really live for eternity, there are some things that just take too much life's energy and time. And we lay aside those things so we can run our race well. And so we got to lay some things aside so we can run better. And because they hinder us and they slow us down and we can't run our race and we can't win. And so let's go back to verse 1. Let us lay aside every weight and the sin which does so easily beset us. And let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Some key things in running your race I just want to mention here. Number one is run. God phrases everything carefully. And man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds out of the mouth of God. And God chooses to run here. He doesn't say walk. Okay, so you're moving. you're moving. I think that I think you have to understand that you're going to be busy if you're going to serve God. It's going to take time. And you're going to have to live a regular life like most people. And then you're going to have a family, and you have a job, and paying your bills, and taking care of your appointments, and all that stuff. And all that for the Lord. And in all of that, you're seeking God's kingdom first. And then you add ministry and church and all the spiritual things and devotions and all those things. You got to go fast. You know, the Bible says redeeming the time. That means buying it back because the days are evil. You got to be going. You can't just let any moss grow under your feet. I mean, you can't just sit around and go slow when time is ticking and your life is flying by and eternity is coming. And you can't earn treasures once you die. You couldn't earn treasures before you're born. You can't earn treasures after you die. It is appointed that a man wants to die, and after this, the judgment is done. And so then you live for eons and eternity and trillions of years with what you earn in this life. Run your race. Run. Be busy for God. Don't lay around. You're binge watching and the world's lost. Amen. And we got to get out there and go. We cannot be on the sideline. We can't. The race is going on. Run your race. Be in the race. It may be a marathon. Run your race. Keep on going and keep on going and keep on going and stay on track. You're running the race. You're not stopping. You're not saying, okay, I'll get back to it tomorrow. It's your whole life. And when you go home, you're still in the race. When you go to work, you're still in the race. And you're running all the time. That means you're not lollygagging around. You're running with focus. You're staying on track. Let me show you Paul's focus in his race. Let's go to 1 Corinthians chapter 9. You're running your race with focus. 1 Corinthians chapter 9. And it's talking about running the race again. Verse 24. It's speaking of running our races. And watch how Paul says, you're running in a race. Let me tell you how I run my race. Verse 24, know ye not that they which run in a race run all? Everybody runs a race. But one receiveth the prize. So run that ye may obtain. Man, I don't want to run a marathon just to run a marathon. Okay. I mean, I don't mind if it was getting me in shape, or I don't mind if I'm going to, you know, get some kind of prize at the end. I don't mind if it's going to, you know, somebody's going to get saved because of it. I don't care. But I don't want to run a race because I, you know, want to breathe faster. That's not what I want to run. I don't want to run a race for that. He says, try to receive a prize. You're going to run your race of your life. You're going to live. If you're saved, you're going to do works or not do works for God. And then you're going to go before the judgment seat of Christ and receive according to the things you've done in your body, according to what he had done, whether it be good or bad. Okay? Run to obtain. Run to win a prize. Run to get eternal rewards and to please God. And every man, verse 25, that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. They're under control, they're controlling themselves. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible. He says, look, the race, those who are wanting masters of their race, their field, their skill, those who are in an Olympic event, those people, they're temperate in everything. What they eat, how they sleep, when they exercise, everything. Everything has to do to become elite. You have to control. And they do it. Unsaved people without the Lord, do it for a corruptible prize that will never matter. But we, for an incorruptible, why shouldn't we be focused and disciplined and doing these things? And every man, verse 25, every man that striveth the mastery is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible. I therefore so run, not as uncertainty fight I, not as one that beateth the air. I'm not just swinging at nothing, but I keep under my body and bring it into subjection, lest by any means, when I preach unto others, I myself should be cast away. So he's talking about running the race there. He's talking about obtaining. And he says, hey, I'm focused. I'm staying on track. I am not just swinging at nothing. I am trying to win a prize. Run. Working hard. It also means not quitting. Not quitting. We got that video? Okay, let's pull this video up so you can hit those lights there. We can start at 3 minutes, I think. All right, good. I'll see if I can point. There's a lady who's supposed to win this race, and she is fifth in the back. She's supposed to win it. She was the first one who fell.
Oh, my goodness.
It was a chain reaction. It started
one in the orange.
She bumped into the Kenyan runner, Anita Jeptok. And then Hassan fell over Jeptok. And now look at the work she has to do. The last thing she wanted today, a full-out sprint for Hassan to try and get back into this.
But if anybody could do it, it would be Hassan. So we've got those top five up there. All she has to do is close this gap right here. And you see Hassan coming up. If she can get in front of these girls right here, now she's in front of these women. Now she's in that sixth position that she needs to make it to the next round.
But how much gas is she using up that she wanted in the tank tonight for the 5,000? Final. Ellie Purrier, St. Pierre out in front. Here comes Hassan, and a pretty staggering last lap after going down. Hull is there as well, and your top six coming through in one big bunch with Stefan.
She won the race.
Going from on the track.
He hit the lights.
The line first in a matter
you can turn it off. She won the race, but she fell. And so you see there that. You know, you're gonna run this race for God, but you can't quit. You can't quit. You know, I was just thinking. You know, I generally when I go somewhere, I just want to. I'm just let's go. You know, if we're driving to Portland, I'm like, all right, no bathroom breaks. Anybody have to go to the bathroom because I'm not stopping. And you know, I kind of do that. And you know, when you got seven kids in the car, you know, it doesn't. You know, and but. But you know that. But sometimes we're doing the, you know, we're taking our time. Sometimes we're doing that on purpose, but we're gonna finish our course. Okay, we're gonna get there. Okay, I could drive to Florida. If I drive to Florida, I can do it very, very quickly and just fly, and do all that and just try to get there really quick and ignore everything else and not see anything. Or I can stop and say, that's a pretty mountain. Or let's pull over there and see that. There is a way you keep on going. You get a flat tire, your car breaks down, but you keep on going. The Bible says a just man falls seven times and rises up again. Keep running. Keep running. You're going to have bad times. You're going to have weak times. You're going to have times where you're struggling. You're going to have times where you fall. But get back up and start running. And you stay on course. And run. Don't get out of the race. Don't get out of the race. Keep moving for God. Keep running. Number two, run with patience. It says right here at the end of verse one, it says, let us run with patience the race that is set before us. There's a lot of things there. Patience is a huge thing in the Bible. It's a huge thing around this passage. You're supposed to be patient in the way you run in this race because you've got to stay on track. You've got to not quit. You don't just sprint and then give up and say, I'm tired. You run with some patience. There is a pace here. Let's go to Hebrews 6 and verse 10 just to show you about patience in the Bible. Just a little bit. There's a lot more than we'll get to, certainly. But I just want to say, have patience. Hebrews 6:10, for God is not unrighteous to forget your work and labor of love, which ye have shown toward his name, in that ye have ministered to the saints and do minister. Now, let's look over to verse 12 also. And be not slothful, but followers of them which through faith and patience inherit the promise. Verse 12. Just look at that. They through faith and patience continuing to go. Hebrews chapter 10. Verse In verse 36, but ye have need of patience, that after ye have done the will of God, ye might receive the promise. Patience. That's a huge thing. After you've done the will of God. Boy, you just saw it today or yesterday in the news. You know, just everybody gets out of everything. Nobody has to continue on. Nobody has to figure it out and work through anything. And you know, paying off people's loans they took out. It's just the way we do things now. Nobody can just say, you know what, I borrowed too much money, I'm going to pay it back. It's going to take me some time. I made a mistake over here, but I'm going to figure it out. You know, I made some mistakes in my marriage, but we're going to rebuild this thing. You got to run with patience. You got to not give up all the time. You got to not just say, I've been running for a long time. I'm 12 miles in. I'm done with this thing. Man, I'm thirsty. I'm tired. Look, you're going to go through some times. The devil's going to attack you. And you're going to go through some low times. And there's going to be times, and just let me tell you, you're not going to feel it. Everybody got to feel it. I'm just not feeling it. Big deal. That's not a Bible thing. That's in America. That you look up in that verse. It's America 2022. That's the reference. And it's not a Bible thing. Jesus wasn't feeling it at the Garden of Gethsemane. He wasn't feeling it. I won't be feeling it tomorrow somewhere over Africa. Okay? I'll be tired and hot and trying to sleep in a bouncy plane with seats that are not meant for men. Okay, and I don't know what they designed those things for, but they are, there's not a lot of leg room or shoulder room. And of course I'm going to get next to a big person for 13 and a half hours. And you know what? I won't be feeling it. It's not all about feeling it. Run with patience. I'm in a race. Man, this is a long haul. I'm going to keep on going. I'm going to keep on doing it. Romans chapter 12 and verse 12. Run your race with patience. I'm so glad that when I started serving the Lord, I decided I was going to do it for the rest of my life. I was not going to quit. I was just going to serve the Lord. And I didn't want any other life, and I just decided whether I'm a bad Christian or good Christian, I was going to give God my best, whether I was weak or whether I was the best Christian in the world or the worst Christian. I was going to keep on serving God. That was my life. Because I wanted to serve the Lord. I was going to run the race till the end. And I wasn't always perfect, but I thank God I kept on running with patience until I grew and learned and grew. And still, you'd think after all this time, I'd be there. So many times newer Christians say, when am I going to quit struggling? I said, I'll let you know when I figure it out. And, we live in victory. We get victory, but, you know. And it's a battle. Let's say that in Hebrews 12. It continues on. And you got to just patiently endure. You're going to fight. You're going to be, the devil's coming after you. Romans 12, in verse 12, rejoice in hope, patient in tribulation, continuing instant in prayer. Revelation chapter 1 and verse 9. I'm just showing you, God says to run patiently. Revelation chapter 1 and verse 9. It says, I, John, who am your brother and companion in tribulation and in the kingdom and patience of Jesus Christ, was in the isle that is called Patmos. And you'll find in Revelation, this is the patience of the saints. He's like, I am with you in our tribulation and our patience. We go through stuff, and we're partners in this thing. We're all struggling sometimes. We're all going through hard times. We're all losing our wallets, we're all going through stuff. And you got to be patient in it. You got to be patient and just keep on running your race. Keep on going. You're driving to Florida. Guess what? You got to stop and get something to eat, and then you go over to the store over here. And it's part of the scenery God has you on. And then all of a sudden you got this little squeaky sound, and you go to the mechanic and he says, we got to change this. So you go over and you find a swimming pool with a hotel at the swimming pool, and you go spend the night and relax and get the car fixed the next day. But you're still going to Florida. You're still on your trip. okay? And wherever God takes you in life, because the phrase he uses in Hebrews 12, he says, let us run with patience the race that is set before us. God has individual races for each one of us. Paul, his race is different than mine. Jesus' race is different than Paul's. Moses was different than Noah's. Stephen's was very short ministry. And John was very old in the Isle of Patmos. God's got a race for you. Don't expect your race to end up exactly the same. You might have a few more heartaches on your race that God puts in your race. He just says, let us run with patience the race that is set before us. He didn't say the race you choose. Because you would have chose the 20-yard dash. And that's what you might have done. And we all have different races. God doesn't expect me to do what the people I'll be with in 2 days. And he doesn't expect them to do what I do. They won't struggle with stuff I struggle with. And I won't struggle with stuff they struggle with. It's a different race. And God will give you grace for your race. But if all you sit there is pout about other people's race, you quit running. Look at their race over there. Why do they get the inside lane? And you're not running anymore. Run with patience the race that is set before you. That's what God gives you. And God is good. And he knows what race to put you in. And he'll give you the strength to get through your race. And don't run somebody else's race. Don't covet somebody else's race. And don't pout about the race that is set before you. Accept it. And run it with patience. Because that's what's been given to you. Let's go back to Hebrews 12. Let us run with patience the race that is set. You ever seen what some Christian goes through? And you're like, how are they doing that? I don't think I can handle that. And I've seen many Christians. I said, I don't think I can do it. I couldn't. Well, I don't have to do it. God did not give me grace to do it. God did not wire me from the womb for that race. But they'll look at me and say, how do you do what you do? I said, it's not that bad. Just do it. Well, I couldn't do that ever. Well, I'm saying the same thing about them sometimes, right? Because we're being given different races for different people. But God knows, man, you are a sprinter. And he knows the other one, you're cross country. And he knows another one, you're a hurdler. And he knows the other one, if I made you hurdle, you'd fall in the first one. And I know that. I know you have a different race. And so he sets a race before you and accept the race he puts you in. And run with patience that race. And sometimes you're going, I did not expect this to go like this. Okay, how many of you in this room, life went exactly like you expected it would? Raise your hand. Okay, that is zero. Okay, life doesn't go like you expect. God put you in a race. And so you trust him. Let's go back, Hebrews 12. That's all verse 1. Wherefore, seeing where it cometh about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight, and the sin which does so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us. Let me just say that. How many of you are around track ever in school or anything? You're on track. When I see the phrase, you got running and then you got patience, that kind of gives you a pace. Okay? You are not sprinting all the time. You ever seen someone who sprinted on too long of a race? Actually, you think, okay, but they're way ahead. Because they sprinted and did too much, they're actually going to finish way farther back than they would have if they would have kept a good pace. I think when I see that verse 1, the way it phrases, run with patience, I think of the 800 meters. I think you are moving, but you aren't sprinting either. And you have some bursts there still at the end. And I think there is times in your life where you're sprinting, where God's got you crazy busy doing things for him and a lot of the things. But most of the time, you're just moving fast. And I think that's a good, healthy way to live. And there's a time where you need a break. And I understand that, and I think you should. But run with patience. Keep on going. Keep a good pace. Go fast for the Lord. But be patient. Don't kill yourself if you can't handle it. And don't take on things you can't handle. But if God gives them to you, you'll be able to handle them. And I know with me, I don't say no when God gives me something. But a lot of times I'm like, I'm already at my peak. And then God says, do this. I say, okay. And then all of a sudden I found out God raised my peak. And then he gives me rest. And all of a sudden I look behind and I'll say, the people are slowed way behind. I can jog for a minute here. And God gives you a break in your life a little bit where he says, okay, I'm going to give you, things are going to go smooth for a while. But keep on running. Don't stop. Keep on running. Don't stop. But now keep the pace and keep on moving. Run with patience the race that is set before you. And I think you should be tired. I think you'd be tired often, but not drop dead exhausted. Because most people can't function that way. Some people can, but if you can't function that way, you'll get exhausted and very discouraged. But sometimes you should be so busy for the Lord, you're tired. And you know, there are cures for insomnia. Okay? And it's called get real busy. Work really hard and have a limited time to sleep. Eventually, your body will learn to sleep and sleep hard. Okay, and this has been proven many times. I do that. And sometimes when you're driving, and other times it just works all the time. And we see in verse 2 that we're supposed to keep our eyes on the finish line, on the prize, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Amen. Now, the way he's going to phrase this is going to matter, but I just want to say, and we'll get into that in a second here, but what he says here is when you're running, your eyes are on Jesus. He's the one at the Bema seat, the reward place, that he's going to give you the crown. He's going to give you the medals. He's going to give you the awards, Amen. And you're looking unto him. Boy, is this hard to do, and do people mess this up? You know, Paul said, I press toward the mark for the prize, the high calling of God in Christ Jesus in Philippians 3. You're keeping your eyes on Jesus. You know, it's one of the funniest things. It's not funny. It's sad, but it's funny because I laugh at everything. But it's funny because somebody will say, well, you know, I want you to know I'm never going to do that. I'm not going to church anymore because there's people at church who did this. And, you know, I was looking at my parents. My parents did this. And then, you know, the youth pastor was kind of a jerk. And, you know, the song leader, he picked songs I don't like. You're just telling us you weren't following Hebrews 12:2. So what did Jesus do to you? Because when you quit serving God, it's not the song leader or mama or daddy or grandpa. It's not the preacher. It's Jesus you quit running for. People are going to disappoint you. People are going to fail you. Looking unto Jesus, he'll always be worth running toward. And people are up and down, and people change, and people all pass away, and people move on, and all kinds of things happen in life. And yet, people can be a blessing. You can run arm in arm with them. They can help you along. You can help them along. But ultimately, you're all looking toward Jesus. Don't serve God because of me. Okay, you're gonna have 2 weeks of no serving God. Okay, and don't serve God because your mom and dad make you. You fall in love with Jesus. Amen. Serve him. Looking into Jesus. That's the way you run your race. It's not some preacher on TV does this and that, and so, you know, I don't believe. Jesus is always good. Amen. And keep your eyes on him. Not on people, not on movements, not on denominations, not on the trends and everything else. Keep your eyes on Jesus. Amen. Looking into Jesus, that's how you run your race. That's how you stay successful, is Jesus is who it's all about. He's the one, but here's the thing. That will keep you from quitting. Watch this. Verse 2, looking into Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, he's everything. He wrote it and he lived it and he fulfilled it. Who, for the joy set before him, endured the cross. I think the joy set before him is well done, thou good and faithful servant, and every soul that is saved. pleasing the Father and then saving us, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. For consider him that endured such contradiction against of sinners against himself, lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. It says, before you quit, remember the cross. And the next verse is pretty harsh. For ye have not yet resisted unto blood, striving against sin. He says, look, your spiritual life, you guys have not even been persecuted and killed and beaten yet. And you're kind of wanting to quit. He says, you have not yet resisted unto blood. You haven't even bled yet for Jesus. He says, before you quit, think of all that Jesus went through on the cross, despising the shame. He didn't just go in the total form of God. He was a man also. He was a God-man. And he felt the pain. He despised the shame of being stripped naked and mocked and falsely accused and everything else he went through. He went through all that. And before you quit, consider him, lest ye be wearied and faint in your mind. Because that's who you're quitting on. And how can you look at him hanging on the cross and now repeat again why you're going to quit?
Because I'm tired on Sunday. My friend made fun of me.
Yeah. Brings back in perspective. You were ready to get your name in the Fox's Book of Martyrs because, you know, you got a hangnail for Jesus. And you got to look back at the cross. Amen. How can you quit on your Lord who died for you? Amen. How can you deny him? How can you live for this world after what he did for you? Consider him. Consider him. Lest ye be wearied and faint in your minds. When you're running the race, look at him and see him. He ran the race, and it was much harder for him. And so keep your eyes on him. Focus on the end. As Paul, let's go to 2 Timothy 4:7. 2 Timothy 4:7. Keep your eyes on Jesus. You won't quit. I have fought a good fight. I have finished my course. Again, the running thing. I have kept the faith. Finish your race. Don't quit on Jesus. You got to keep your eyes on Jesus if you're going to finish. And he says, and you know what? Henceforth, there is laid up for me a crown of righteousness, which the Lord, the righteous judge, shall give me and at that day, and not to me only, but to all them that love his appearing. Let me go back to Hebrews 12 and just finish up there. I just want to say, run your race with patience and keep your eyes on Jesus. It's important you do that because the pressure's on. The world, we're getting toward the end. There's a lot of persecution. There's a lot of mocking. There's a lot of morality pressing on us. Our righteous souls are vexed from day to day like Lot's was in the world we live in. And we have got to be focused to finish our race. Because in the last days, many shall depart from the faith. Yeah. So you better be a focused runner who's not beating the air and staying, keeping your eyes on Jesus. Look at verse 2 again. Looking into Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross. Verse 3, for consider him that endured such contradiction of sinners. Verse 7, if ye endure chastening, God dealing with you as with sons. Enduring. It's one thing I didn't like about long distance running. It hurts. It's hard. And long distance serving to God the rest of your life is sacrifice and work. Endure. Endure hardness as a good soldier. It's a good Bible word. How can I get out of this? What can I do? Is there a pill? How can I get out of this? Do you have a book I can read? And everybody tries to write a book. How to go through a horrible divorce without any pain. Okay. Good luck in that. How to serve God, never get persecuted. Well, I don't think the Bible, I think the Bible says all that live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecution. How to keep all your friends and all your bad habits and love Jesus. Be nice if we had all those books that would do those things. Be nice if you could just live this life without having pain and attacks and wrestling not against flesh and blood. But it's just going to be hard sometimes. And sometimes you're running the race and you're running up a hill and your calves are burning. I've heard. And sometimes you're gonna be serving God, doing everything just right, and you're gonna go through some health issues. And sometimes you're gonna be very kind and love somebody, and they're gonna be nasty back to you. Well, what do? Endure. You endure. And you just say, Lord, you see, I'm still running my race. I'm hurting right now, but I'm still running. You put this race in front of me, and Lord, there's some hills in this race, or Lord, there's some hard sprints in this race, or Lord, this is a long race, and Lord, you know I'm hurting. Give me strength. Give me grace. And God will have somebody stand at the side of the road with a cup of Gatorade to help you. God will give you a little downhill for a while. God will give you strength. You don't know why, but all of a sudden you start running faster, and you feel stronger. But that's all the Lord. You just got to endure. Endure hardness. And Christ endured. And you got to endure sometimes, because running the race isn't easy. The guy who, you know, did the marathon thing, you know, it's named for a run, right? You're all public school kids. Forgot. So, you know, a guy ran a race, what is it, 24.3 miles? Habla ingles. And so the guy ran whatever. That's very funny. None of you have any idea of how long a marathon is. Okay, 26.2 miles. A guy came to bring a report on a battle, and he ran the whole thing, and he died at the end. Okay, and when he brought the report, he fell over and died. And it's not funny, is it? And but he. Hey, look, running's hard. That's why I don't do it. And but run that race, and enduring. It's a long race. Don't sprint a marathon. But don't get out of the marathon either. Stay on the track. If your pace that God gave you and your ability and in your race, God put you on a marathon with some big hills and some hurdles and some pits and some mud things to crawl through. That's what you got. Endure it. But keep on running. Don't quit. And consider him. Keep your eyes on Jesus, and you can finish your race. Amen? Let's pray. Lord, thank you for giving us the ability and the wisdom of how to run a race. You said a lot in those two or three verses, Lord, just to really help us to run the race like we should, and I pray you would. I pray, Lord, you keep this these people just serving you, Lord, and keep me serving you. Keep our eyes on you, Lord. You're the motivation. Why would we strive against sin our whole lives if we didn't love you? And help us to accept the race we've been given. Help us to run. Help us not to get out of the race and quit. And help us to run with patience. Help us to do this until we die for our lifetime. Whether we're a great runner or not, whether we break any world records, or just run and get across the finish line at the end, may we win. And when you fall, may we get back up and run again. Lord, thank you. You showed us how to do these things. We give you the glory. And I ask for people who maybe are a little discouraged in their race, they would keep running and endure and finish for you. We pray in Jesus' name.